So today we're going to introduce you the basic theory for analyze composite mechanics. And one of the most important part is called shear-lag theory. So as you can imagine, for most of the composite, it is going to be made from fiber and matrix. But most of the time, okay, it's easy to think about when you look at a simple picture here. The middle one is the fiber, the outside one is the matrix. Okay, when you load it, okay, if it is a long fiber, what will happen is you load it, the fiber and matrix deform simultaneously, so the strength of them are the same. So essentially, you don't have any degradations in that case for long fiber, continuous fiber. But what if you have a picture like this? It's a discontinuous fiber, where you have a very short fiber embedded in the matrix, and then when you load it again, from the matrix rather from both, now you will see actually the stress transfer is first loaded on the matrix, right? And then the matrix will deform and it will transfer the stress to the fibers. But because the fiber and the matrix has such a big difference in their modulus, so EF modulus over EM sometimes have 100 difference. So if you look at the picture, in reality actually when you load it, this line here is the stress distribution stress. But when you load it, what happens is the stress is distorted. Okay? So it's not uniform anymore. So it starts here, okay, you have quite a uniform stress at the beginning, but it starts to change when you're getting close to the fiber. So what we can see here, this stress field is quite distorted along the fiber. And when the system is normally undergo this such kind of load transfer, this induces shear stress, because there's a mismatch between the fiber and matrix, so there's some shear stress developed between the matrix and the fiber. So you want to load the fiber, but how? The only mechanism is introduce some shear stress, okay, at the interface. So that's the basic pictures you can see here. The stress is the lag. The main word, lag, why there is a lag, is you're not directly apply the stress on the fiber. So there's a delay, because you need a matrix to passing the force to the fiber. So that's how the word lag comes from. And if we move on, let's just think about how to model a graphene nanoplatelet reinforcements composite. So if you think about a picture like this, you have a matrix which is the dark color, and the rectangular shape here is the graphene. And graphene is like a brick in this manner. And you can think about the thickness of the graphene at the moment with T, small T. And we can just zoom in, just take one small piece of this material and to look at the micromechanics. And you can think about, okay, now let's look at 3D picture, and you have a graphene in this case, and let's just take a small unit, so the distance from the edge from that side to the side towards us is dx, and the thickness here is very tiny of the graphene is t, small t. And for the total thickness for the composite, it's a big T here. I just rewrite again, so make it larger for you. And the picture here is showing the shear stress, okay, tau, as actually applied when we load it in actually, but in this small area, what happened is more about the shear stress, how the shear stress applied on the nanoplatelet. Let's call it flake. Okay. So this flake, if you zoom in, okay, let's just do a stress analysis. What happens is this small flake is undergo what happened here is the shear stress, tau I. Okay, and then if you imagine, there must be also some other force to balance it or stress. So that is sigma F, the uniaxial normal stress, okay, as acting on the plane cross section. Remember, axial normal stress is acting perpendicular to the cross section, while the shear stress is parallel to the cross section, to the fibers. And on the left hand side, for this small unit, you have the stress sigma F. On the right hand side is sigma F plus D sigma F. So there's a slight difference between these two parts, and that will be balanced with the shear force or shear stress in this case. So let's think about the force balance. Okay, adding all the force together should be equal to zero, right? So let's add them together. So think about now the through thickness is just a unit, one. Okay, B is one, through thickness. And now we imagine the first part is coming from the tensile stress on the left hand side. Let's think about the coordinate system X and Y. So X towards that side on the right side is the positive. Now on the left hand side is the negative value. And plus sigma F plus D sigma F. So this is from the actual stress. And there's another shear stress to balance it out, which should be here is tau I. Tau I, is that right? Actually, it's not right, because all this stress need time cross-section area. Uniaxial stress is acting along these cross-sections. The cross-section area is the thickness T times 1. 1 is the B, the through thickness, okay? And this should be balanced with the shear stress. The shear stress, you can see, is acting along the surface here. So it has a surface of what? Tau I times dx. And the thickness B, again, is 1. That's equal to 0, right? So now let's just cancel out the left-hand side. You have T times, there's a minus sign canceled here, so D sigma F. And plus tau DX. Okay, let's just cross the X to avoid confusion. So that's equal to 0. So now we find the relationship between what? Between, let's say, we rearrange the equation such that we get d sigma f over dx, the distance, the small distance dx. Now it's equal to minus, so that should be tau on top, t on bottom. Okay, right? That's the equation we find. So that's kind of give us indications. The stress, actually, the shear stress, tau I, is a relationship between the kind of a different derivative of the sigma F across the S, X, and t is the constant, right? So that's not a linear relationship from that formula we can see. That's why we see a distorted stress. So that's one important formula we just found from the force balance. And that's essentially the equation we're showing here, tau I, that's the force balance. And it goes to this equation, right? Exactly the same things we found. So the behavior of this kind of flake in the matrix mostly can model by the shear-lag series. And let's see how we move on with that relationship we got. So imagine the resin has an overall thickness of big T here. So it's assumed that the flake and the matrix both deform elastically, and there's no debonding between the fiber or flake and the matrix. So if when you load it, there is a displacement on the matrix U, okay? Let's say there's a matrix has a displacement of U. So let's make it easier to understand. So suppose that's the flake in a 2D, and you have a matrix now deformed more like this way, okay? It's under shear, so it's a U. Is the displacement of that matrix, and on the bottom side, I assume there's a similar picture here. It's also matrix. Let's shape this. This is the flake, and this is the matrix. So now, let's first off ask ourselves. If we know the displacement of the matrix is U, and for that small unit is called dU, and the shear strength of that matrix is essentially, because it's like a simple shear problem, the shear strength normally, if you remember, is the general equation is probably dU over dx plus du over dy. That's a general equation, but for this case, we're just looking at a simple shear. One of them are cancelled, is zero. And the angle of this simple shear problem is, think about that, is a tangent theta. Tangent theta is this gamma. Is du over dz. So sorry, I think it should be the theta is around here. Okay, to give you the rotation. So that's du over dz. That's to give you the shear strength of the matrix. Okay, that's the basic definition of shear strength. And if you know the shear strength with the has a relationship between the shear stress and the shear modulus, right? It's like Young's modulus is equal to the stress over the strain. It's very similar. So here is the shear modulus is equal to the shear stress over the shear strain. So gamma is essentially, you can rearrange that. Right, so gamma equal to du over dz. So du over dz essentially is the gamma. The gamma can be rearranged to tau over shear modulus. Right, so essentially that's come here to this equation. Du over dz is tau over gm. And the shear force per unit length carried by the matrix is then transmitted to the flake surface through the layer of resin. So the shear strain at any distance z is given by this equation. So the shear strain is at the surface, you can assume it's uniform to transfer. It doesn't matter where the location along the z direction. So that can be used that equation. So how we can link the one we have derived here to the final equation we got here? So it's just a matter of rearrange the equations. Okay, so let's say we got this equation from here. I think those next slides will show exactly what you will expect it. So du over dz is tau I over gm. The next slide is essentially, okay, what it's doing here, let's just copy that one, du over dz equal to tau I over gm. That's the equation we derived. And then you can actually do the integrations if you know the boundary conditions. The boundary conditions, essentially, you do the integration on both sides, but you know the boundary condition is on the left hand side, you know the displacement of the ut, okay? What is ut? T is the displacement of okay, let's just write that down. It's UF and UT. I just want to rearrange the equation DU. I will explain that later. And I rearrange this DZ to the right side. Okay, so I know this part is more like a constant. So just take it out. And I know the boundary condition of the z. Z is from the half of the flake. So imagine the picture is more like this. In the middle. The middle part here is zero, and along that direction is z. So because you know the thickness of here is half of the small t, and you know the total thickness of the composite is half of big T, so you actually do an integration along z direction, and the displacement u, you know, okay, there's one end this is the matrix displacement, and this is the fiber displacement. They're not the same. When you load it, there's a delay, it's just kind of a lag. So the matrix may move faster than the fiber, okay? That's just expected. Matrix is soft. So now we have these equations. You just substitute the boundary condition here to when you do a general integration. So this is just the du, when you do the integration, you just substitute the boundary ut and uf. And similarly, dz, you substitute that two boundary here, which essentially come to the right part. This is the equation for the right part. And the question is how we link that to the strain. Now we have the displacement. The strain, if you know, the strain for the fiber is essentially the you do the derivative of the fiber displacement against the x coordinate, that gives you the strain. That's the normal definition of strain. Okay, the change of the displacement over the original length. This gives you the EF. Similar, EM is equal to DUT over DX. Right? So what you need to do is here, just do the derivative on both sides, this and that. You do the derivative on the left hand side, this against x, so this will all convert to the equation here, right? So ut, do the derivative against dx, will become ef. Similarly, uf, although there's probably a minus sign here, okay, will become this side. And on the right side, you do the derivative again, dx again. But there's one thing you need to remind yourself, there's something rearranged, which is tau I is given by the equation. Let's copy the tau I here. It's this one, d sigma f over dx. Okay, let's copy the equation here. D sigma f over dx is minus tau I over t, right? This is the equation. And what you need to do is just substitute the tau I with that equation. So let's just say tau I is just minus d sigma f dx times the t. The t comes to the left. So now it's this equation, and you substitute the equation 1.23. So now let's just rearrange the right side. Let's rearrange the right side first to give it a clear understanding. So that is 2gm is still in the bottom, and in the top is the whole equation here. Let's just see how we can write it nicely. Okay, there's a minus sign here, and this is d sigma f dx times t, and t minus t, that's the original side on the right side before the derivative. Now let's do the derivative on the dx on the right side, so that will essentially you got a double derivative d sigma f dx squared, and t minus t, okay, times t, that's right. Is anything I missed? T minus t, okay, on the left hand side I'm fine, that's done. And on the right side there must be, when you do the double derivative, t, okay, let's just see where we missed that. It should be noted that shear-lag is not, okay. Alright, so differentiating this 1.23. So on this side, this part is the same. This is exactly the same. And 2gm is also the same. The minus sign go to left. Okay, I understand. Because there is a condition, since t is much larger than small t, so you can omit this small t in this sense. So that's why this can be equal to t if t is much larger than small t. Okay, so now you get a simple equation, which is this one, and rearrange it. So this is like a ordinary differentiation equation. You solve it by, you can now define n. This is the one I mentioned, is the length distribution factor n, which is equal to some constant we got here. Okay, so now just the matter of solving this equation, which essentially, once you do the math, you solve that sigma is equal to something related to that. EF is the fibre modulus, EM is the strain of the matrix, and there's some terms where you need to determine the constant here. So I'm not going to go too detail on that part. After substitute some boundary conditions, you can solve this constant d here, and eventually the final equation is come to here. Sigma f is equal to EF, Young's modulus of fiber, times the matrix strain with the side on this part. Because for the flake, you can actually introduce aspect ratio S. Essentially, is the length of this flake divided by the thickness T. So once you introduce to this equation essentially you replace the T by L over T, go to here, L over S, okay? So once you substitute here, the final equation becomes that part. Okay, so you can even simplify that because you know sigma F over EF essentially is the strain of fiber, right? And then this is become just the fiber strain is equal to matrix strain and minus this functions, okay? That's essentially how the shear-lag series give you the result. It's just these equations. And also when you using the equation 1.18, if you remember that, I think I remember it, is d sigma f dx minus this tau I over t. You can rearrange that and you get the tau I is equal to that equations. Okay? So that's what I mentioned before. You got this equation and that equation, which got one. Number one is the relationship between the fiber strain and the matrix strain by this equation. Number two is the interfacial shear stress developed between the fiber and matrix. Okay? So you may ask how we can use these things you derived. So in reality, actually, that's a good question. And in experiments, we can measure some of the parameters here. So people are actually using something like this setup. You have a PMMA on top and on bottom, and then you make a graphene model on layers. So essentially, you pull in. It's just a PMMA, and you measure what happens on the graphene. Okay. There's a very smart method essentially to achieve it, because to measure the strain on the graphene is really difficult, it's very small. There's an optical method called the Raman scatter, Raman. Okay, what it's doing is you're shining a laser. Okay, you have a laser just shining on the graphenes. Even without loading it, there's some pattern which is a typical pattern for the graphene mono layers. You have the G peak, you have the 2D peak. But the scientists have found actually once you stretch it, the 2D peak will shift somewhere here. Okay? So it will shift along one direction. And scientists have measured that there's a linear relationship. Depending on how much you apply the strain, for example, apply a larger strain, the shift amount of Raman parameters will shift much more. So it's a linear relationship. So that when you do the experiments, you only need to measure how much you shift. You can see from the Raman shift of the wave numbers, you can measure the other way, the strain of your fiber or the graphene here. Okay, this is very very unique method here. And then the researchers has verified what they measured. Now you can actually, you put a strain gauge on the PMMA, okay, strain gauge. You can measure how much strain you apply on the matrix, which in this case just 0.4%. It's just this 0.4%, but you can measure the fiber strain. Let's say this is the fiber strain by using the Raman scatters. And you want to calibrate what you have derived in that equation. What you don't know actually essentially is the N, this length factor, is the unknown factors. But by changing the NS, let's say NS, this together, both consider the length factor and also aspect ratio, you can actually feed the data. So you can find here, probably NS equal to 20 give you the best fit. So now this is the technique actually to back up the NS factors, which you normally don't know from your other experiments. So this is the experiment, you actually use the equation and feed the data and back up the NS. Then the NS can be used in the later stage, the computational homogenizations. Okay, so if you can actually plot the interfacial shear stress we derive from the equation, you can find, okay, again, there's a very big difference. If you think about the shear stress along the fiber, if the fiber is roughly around here, the shear stress will just decay to zero at this area. But if you coming close to the fiber, you can see the shear stress coming is very large, and it's follow this equations. Okay, so that's a very nice study. So now the question is how we apply the shear-lag theory to homogenize our graphene composite. If I give you the graphene composite, basically the simplest method using rule of mixture, where you adding up the modulus times the volume fractions, it gives the total modulus. But for the this is only valid for long fiber. Okay, long fibers, where you don't have any this kind of shear lag effect. So the fiber can pick up the load as you apply the stress. But for the graphene composite, most of the time the graphene is much smaller and it's not continuous. You need to think about the modified series, which is following this review papers. And you can just using the modified rules mixture, where you have two extra parameters, eta zero and eta L. Now, like I said, eta L probably is the things we are related to the shear-lag theory. And eta L is equal to 1 minus tangent h, ns over 2. So the ns is the one we actually back up from the Raman experiment. And n is the shear-lag fitting parameters. Okay, so as we have done the experiment, then we know the ns. Then we can back up this nl easily. And also this equation also suggesting that if NS is increasing, that means that is close to long fiber. This term will getting close to zero, so that's why that meaning if it's a long fiber, eta L will be equal to 1. There's no lockdown effect. And there's another factor is called eta naught, which is this orientation factors. Orientation factor, again, you can using Raman techniques, the polarized Raman, to measure that orientation factors. So again, follow this review papers, you can find the method, how you can use the experiment to characterize the eta zero. So most of them can be measured from the Raman, and eventually you got this factors. Okay, so I'm not going to go into detail for this part, but this gives you an overview of all the shear-lag theory and how you can use that for the homogenization. Okay, that's done.